please the ruling of the court. When the petitioner in this case closed his case with the testimony of his third and last witness, Mr. Robert Joseph Metenuno, on the 8th of February 2021, the court, as our procedural rules and trials provide, called on the first respondent to open his defense by the calling of his witness, whose witness statement had already been filed on the orders of the court. This witness happened to be the chairperson of the first respondent, Mrs. Jane Adokwe Mensa. Counsel for the first respondent told the court that he had weighed or scrutinized the case of the petitioner as presented by his three witnesses, and in his view, the petitioner had not provided any substantial evidence in proof of his case for which the first respondent had to mount the witness box to testify in answer. The first respondent therefore prayed the court to determine the petition on the oral testimonies and data presented by the petitioner through his witness and decide the main issue at stake, which is whether or not none of the 12 presidential candidates who contested the 7th December 2020 presidential elections did obtain more than 50% of the valid votes cast in the said elections. The second respondent, who was declared as winner of the elections by the first respondent, whose declaration ignited the filing of the instant petition, associated himself with the first respondent on his prayer and told the court he also did not desire to give any testimony through his attorney as contemplated. According to him, the petitioner did not discharge the burden imposed on him by law to produce sufficient evidence to buttress his case, so there was no need for him to say anything in explanation. He supported first respondent's prayer that the court should resolve the petition on petitioner's evidence or since the burden was on him to prove the reliefs he is seeking. This position of the respondents to close their case without adducing any evidence at all, which the law permits them to do, did not go down well with the petitioner. Counsel for the petitioner resisted this position of the respondent and prayed the court to compel the first respondent chairperson specifically to testify as first respondent witness, since he had filed a witness statement to that effect and therefore had elected to testify. As for the second respondent, petitioner said he was not bothered about his refusal to testify. The court adjourned for the parties to submit legal arguments for its determination of the matter, which they did. On the 11th of February 2021, the court dismissed the petitioner's objection to the respondent's decision not to testify and gave reasons in the written ruling delivered for that purpose. One of the reasons given by the court in dismissing the objection of the petitioner was that this court could not compel the first respondent to call this chairperson as its witness as Rule 3E sub Rule 5 of Order 38 of the High Court Civil Procedure Rule CR 47 as amended by CR 87 permits them to do so. Immediately after the court's ruling on the issue, the petitioner filed the instant application. It was filed on the same 11th February 2021 and almost around the same time that this court delivered its ruling, dismissing petitioner's objection to the closure of respondent case. There is no doubt that the instant motion was triggered by the ruling of this court, in which the court endorsed the respondent's prayer not to volunteer any evidence whatsoever. The petitioner did not hide his feelings and expressed it lucidly under paragraph 15, 16, and 17 of his affidavit in support of the application as follows. Quote, 15, as a result of the ruling of the court of Thursday, 11 February 2021, it has become necessary, I am advised and very believe, that my counsel use the subpoena powers of the court under Order 38 Rule 10 of CR 47 to compel the attendance of the chairperson of first respondent to appear and testify in court. 16. At the time my counsel closed my case, the representation that had been made by each respondent to the court, and specifically to me, was that witnesses who had filed witness statements were going to testify. It therefore came as a surprise that both counsel for respondents announced on Monday, 8 February 2021, that this was no longer the case. 17. My counsel is seeking leave of the court to reopen my case to enable the subpoena referred to above to be served on Mrs. Jane Adokwe Mensa, so she can appear before the court to testify. End of quote. The application is headed motion on notice for leave to reopen case of petitioner to enable chairperson of electoral commission to testify. From all indications, the target of the petitioner in this application is not the second respondent who has also filed a witness statement through an attorney, but the chairperson of the first respondent. The application, which is not known under our rules of procedure, has been brought under our inherent jurisdiction as contended by counsel for the petitioner. According to petitioner, he is praying the court to reopen his case, which this court had declared closed on his own instructions, to enable him to subpoena the chairperson of the first respondent to testify as a hostile or adverse witness. The petitioner advanced almost the same argument he made before the court during his objection to the closure of the respondent case. The respondent have strongly opposed the application and have cited both local and foreign judicial decisions to support their arguments. Legal counsel for the petitioner urged on the court that he wanted the chairperson of first respondent to testify as an adverse witness of the petitioner. Counsel also made references to paragraphs 31, 32, and 33 of the affidavit in support of the application as to why he wanted the chairperson of the first respondent to testify. The other point petitioner's lawyer kept urging on the court was that the chairperson performs an important constitutional duty and must be made to account to the people for her stewardship and to vindicate herself. The question is, how can the chairperson of first respondent vindicate herself when he is not on trial before us? He was neither being personally sued nor arraigned before this court on any complaint or accusation, civil or criminal, for which she was to explain or account to anybody for anything he has done or not done. It is the institution, the Electoral Commission, which he has, that has been accused by petitioner of not having performed his constitutional duty according to law. Does the petitioner need the personal testimony of the chairperson of the institution sued before he could prove or establish the alleged non-performance of his constitutional duty by the first respondent? We do not think so. What indeed baffles this court is the intimation by counsel for the petitioner that he intends to call the chairperson of first respondent as an adverse witness. Black's Law Dictionary, 9th edition, edited by Brian A. Ghana, defined a hostile witness as, quote, a witness who is biased against the examining party, who is unwilling to testify, and who is identified with an adverse party, also termed adverse witness, end of quote. A hostile or adverse witness, as the definition shows, as we understand the term in practice, is therefore a witness who has been called by a party to testify in support of his or her case and who, whilst in the witness box under examination in chief, performs hostile and gives evidence contrary to the party who called him and in support of the opponent's case. The party in such circumstances can apply to the court to treat such a witness who is already in the witness box as a hostile or adverse witness. This would enable the party calling him to cross-examine him as if he is a witness of his opponent to solicit the truth in respect of the issue at stake. A witness who has not yet entered the witness box to testify cannot therefore be called an adverse or hostile witness under any circumstances. The court exercises its inherent jurisdiction inter alia to correct errors in procedure and to ensure that no miscarriage of justice is occasioned during a trial. Inherent jurisdiction, which is also referred to as the inherent powers doctrine, is the principle that allows courts to deal with adverse matters over which they have intrinsic authority. The petitioner has not demonstrated to us in any way that the decision of the respondent not to testify, which was upheld by this court in its ruling of 11 February 2021, has occasioned him any miscarriage of justice. That decision is backed by law, particularly our rules of procedure, case law, and settled practice. We demonstrated this in our ruling of 11 February 2021, when we rejected petitioner's objection to the respondent's decision not to testify. At the time this application was filed, petitioner had expressly closed his case, likewise the respondents. He is therefore seeking our discretion to reopen his case and to lead further evidence, which evidence he never disclosed to the court. He is not entitled to his prayer as of right. It is subject to our discretion, and before we can exercise our discretion in his favor, we must satisfy certain basic conditions as laid down by case law. The general expectation imposed on all litigating parties is to place the whole of their case before the court at the time of the hearing. The process of invoking the inherent jurisdiction of the court at the close of the case of the party to reopen a closed case in order to address fresh or further evidence is thus an necessary step which the important of finality of litigation forms upon, save the presence of exceptional circumstances. In the Canadian case of Oakley versus Royal Bank of Canada, 2013 ONSC 145, 2013 OJ, number 109, Supreme Court, Andrew J. held, quote, the court requires the parties to litigation to bring forward their whole case in both civil and criminal matters. The Crown or plaintiff must produce and enter in its own case all clearly relevant evidence it has. On the other hand, a trial judge has the discretion to permit a party to reopen its case. This discretion, however, must be exercised judicially. It must involve a scrupulous balancing of the accountability of counsel for decisions regarding the prosecution of his case and the interest of justice. End of quote. Though this Canadian case is not binding on us, it has a persuasive effect as it espouses the principles governing reopening of closed case for the purposes of adducing fresh or further evidence. Back at home, our own Benny JSC, then Benny J, gave a similar holding in the case of Combat vs. Lambia, 1989-91 Ghana Law Report, page 324, at page 326, as follows, quote, the general rule of evidence was that after a prisoner's case was closed, a judge should only call a fresh witness when a new matter had arisen as improviso, which could not have been foreseen. Said witness could, in a civil case, only be called with the consent of all parties. And although the evidence decree 1975 NRCD 323 permitted the court to call or recall witnesses, it was subject to the general rule. End of quote. Though the above definition made reference to the calling or recall of a witness by the trial court, the same principle applies where it is any of the parties who apply for such a call or recall after the close of their cases. One of the leading cases on application to reopen cases is the Canadian case of 671122 Ontario Limited versus Sagas Industries Canada Incorporation 2001 SCC 59 2 SCR 983 SCC, which was referred to as by counsel for second respondent. In that case, the court approved of a two-state test, which was first articulated in Scott versus Cook 1970 OG number 14872 OR 769. That test, which is intended to assist the trial judge in exercising his or her discretion to reopen the trial, requires the application, the applicant to show that the evidence he or she seeks to adduce is such that if it had been presented at trial, it would probably have changed the results. And two, prove that such evidence could not have been obtained by reasonable diligence before the trial. End of quote. This same test is what a party who intends to lead evidence or further evidence in the trial or on appeal must satisfy before a court could grant such a request. In the case of Poku versus Poku 2007-2008 Supreme Court of Ghana Law Report 996 at page 998, which was cited by counsel for the second respondent, this court, Perwood CG, expressed the principle succinctly in the assist an applicant who has made a general attempt to look for the evidence and has met with failure. Courts ought to be adept at masking attempts by a dissatisfied party coming through the back door and under the cloak of having come by new or fresh evidence, seeking to fill in gaps or lapses in his or her case, for the rule is not meant to aid the slothful or the indolent, the careless, negligent or reckless litigant, whether acting pro se or true counsel. The application is not granted on compassionate grounds, neither is it meant to give the sloven, particularly a litigant acting through counsel and who fails at the trial to marshal his facts carefully or fails to conduct his case properly by presenting essential evidence at the trial or through the necessary cross-examination, or also fails to conduct the necessary investigations which would have thrown light or strengthen his case or give him or her a second chance at rebuilding his or her case. End of quote. This same point was made in the case of Amabor v. Obus, 1982-83, Wanganal Report 585 at 587 per Osejuri Reji, which was referred to us by Nene Council for the first respondent. The court, relying on the English case of Young v. Kensho and Burton v. Kensho, 1989-81, Law Terms 531 and 532, Court of Appeal, held that the rationale behind the denial or grant of permission to order a new trial upon the discovery of further evidence must be the same as that which denies or grants permission to leave further evidence after the close of the case for the parties. In all the examples cited, the defendant did testify, and the plaintiff found the need to call for fresh or further evidence to buttress their case, though the courts, in almost all the instances, refused applications. In the instant case, however, the respondent decided not to testify at all. So no situation arises for there to be the need for the petitioner to call further or fresh evidence to clarify anything, be it a doubt or a point raised in the testimony of the respondents, since there was none. The petitioner in his submissions made reference to Section 26 of the Evidence Act 1972 NRCD 75 NRC 3 23, which he says operates as a stopper against the first respondent for failing or refusing to call a witness as contemplated by the filing of a witness statement. This section provides, quote, except as otherwise provided by law, including the rule of equity, when a party has, by that party's own statement, act or omission, intentionally and deliberately caused or permitted another person to believe a thing to be true and to act upon that belief, the truth of the thing shall be conclusively presumed against that party or the successors in interest of that party in proceedings between A, that party or the successors in interest of that party, and B, the relying person or successors in interest of that person. End of quote. We wish to state emphatically that Section 26 of the Evidence Act, which is on conclusive presumptions, is not applicable in this case in view of Order 38(3)(5). The rules permit a party to call or not to call a witness who has filed a witness statement to testify, as the mere filing of a witness statement does not constitute an election to testify, as we rightly held in our ruling on the 11th of February 2021. Again, the petitioner did not decide to close his case after the testimony of his third witness just because the chairperson of the first respondent had filed a witness statement. This is because in law, a plaintiff or petitioner does not require evidence from his or her adversary in an adversarial system as ours to prove his or her case. The authorities are alleging that a plaintiff or petitioner succeeds on the strength of his or her own case, but not on the weakness of his or her adversary's case. Conclusion. We wish to reiterate that by settled practice, and in the absence of express rules to that effect, a trial judge, just like this court, in this trial petition, has a wide discretion to reopen proceedings before a judgment is rendered. That discretion, however, is one which should be exercised sparingly and with restraint, as motions to reopen necessarily involve a balancing of the accountability of counsel for decisions regarding the prosecution of this case and the interests of justice. Accordingly, in weighing the propriety of reopening proceedings to permit new additional evidence to be led or tendered, the court would typically consider the following broad questions. Would the evidence, if it had been presented during the trial, have had any influence on the result? Two, could the evidence have been obtained before or during trial by the exercise of reasonable diligence? The court will also assess the relevance, necessity, and materiality of the proposed evidence, the effect, if any, the reopening may have on the expeditious conduct of the trial at large, and the importance of the integrity of the trial process, and finally, whether the other party will be prejudiced if the reopening is allowed, or a miscarriage of justice perpetrated if it is not. As we've already indicated in this ruling supra, the petitioner in this application has not given an inkling of the new or fresh evidence he wants to bring to the fore through the chairperson of the first referendum, and how that evidence could assist the court to do justice in the matters under consideration in this petition. Neither has he disclosed how that evidence will advance the course of this petition. For the above stated reasons, we find no merit whatsoever in the petitioner's application to reopen his case for the sole purpose of compelling his adversary's intended witness to testify through his subpoena without indicating the sort of evidence he intends to solicit from the said witness and how that evidence is going to help the court in resolving the dispute before us. We accordingly refuse the application and proceed without any hesitation to dismiss him.
As the court pleases.
We are grateful to the court.
Lords, we are most grateful.
We have listened to your ruling, and we will obtain a copy of it. I have to say, my lord, that we are struck by the fact that Section 72 of the Evidence Decree or the Evidence Act is not referred to, but Black's Law Dictionary is referred to. But in any case, my lords, I wish to notify your lordship that we have filed this morning, just this in the last half hour. So we have filed an application for review of your ruling of 11th February. And in connection with that, we are also filing an application for stay of proceedings pending the hearing of that review application. And no doubt, the next steps in this case will be dependent on those applications.
Yeah, Counselor, excuse me. Has the registrar given you any date for the hearing of that application?
Not as far as I know. I believe
it is being filed.
It is being filed. I believe so, because this was about 20 minutes ago, and I don't think that the date has been given yet.
Okay. So we already indicated that this case has been adjourned to Thursday. So you will come on Thursday. Yes. If the motion is fixed for tomorrow, then we can come and take the motion. Yes. If it is for Thursday, you come and take the Thursday. But our orders still stand. So the court stands adjourned to Thursday. Please.